challenge versus threat, it's not the same, even if the magnitude of the problem is the same. And so putting yourself in a challenging, let's call it mind frame, you can't just do that by magic. Putting yourself in a challenging mind frame is much easier on you psychophysiologically, because you don't go into the generalized stress response to the same degree. And you're activating your exploratory and seeking systems, which are dopaminergically mediated and that involve positive emotion. So if you can face something voluntarily rather than having it chase you, it's way better for you psychophysiologically. So that's partly why, well, it's worthwhile to go find the dragon in its lair instead of waiting for it to come and eat you. So, and especially when you also add the idea that if you go find the dragon in its lair, you might find it when it's a baby instead of a full-fledged bloody monster that is definitely going to take you down. And so that's part of the reason why, well, there's a whole bunch of things that emerge out of that observation, like don't avoid small problems that you know are there. Face them, because they'll grow into big problems all by themselves. And you can think about, imagine the tax department sends you a notification. You owe them like $300. Well, that's annoying. Maybe you don't even want to open the letter. Or maybe if you do, you just put it on the shelf. But that damn thing doesn't just sit there like a piece of paper on the shelf, right? You ignore that for 5 or 6 years, it's going to become attached to all sorts of horrible things. And if you ignore it long enough, you get the idea. It's going to turn into something that is completely unlike the little piece of paper that it's written on. And many, many problems in life are like that. You'll see that they pop their ugly little head up, and you know, and you might want to turn away. You might not want to think about it, which is the easiest way of turning away, right? You just don't attend to it. It's not like you repress it or anything like that. You just fail to attend to it. And that's as a long-term strategy, it's dismal. It's also something I think that's more characteristic of people who are high in neuroticism and high in agreeableness, because agreeable people don't like conflict. And people who are high in neuroticism, who are high in negative emotion, are hit harder per unit of uncertainty or threat. And so, you know, and that's partly why in psychotherapy, a lot of times the people you see need assertiveness training, so that would be the opposite of agreeableness, or they need to help get their anxiety and emotional pain under control. Those are not the only reasons. There's antisocial behavior, but you can't fix that in therapy in all likelihood. There's alcoholism. There's lots and lots of other reasons, but those are two major reasons.
I bought this cottage up north in northern Canada, and it's very dark up there. And you can go onto the dock at night, and it's dark enough so you can see the Milky Way, you know, and it has to be pretty dark before you can see the Milky Way. And it's very impressive. And you know what that's like if you've been out to see the night sky, or maybe you feel the same way when you see the Grand Canyon or a remarkable waterfall or some particularly beautiful scene, or perhaps you feel that way in a cathedral, or more likely you feel that way when you're listening to music that really grips you, right? And it's all the same experience. It's an experience of awe, and it's way down low in your nervous system, like the orienting reflex. It's not a cognitive response precisely. It's a precognitive emotional significance. And you look up at the night sky, and it fills you with a sense of awe. But it doesn't just do that. You see, it activates the impulse to imitate, which is a very deep motivation in human beings. We're unbelievable mimics. We mimic each other all the time, which is why we all use the same words, let's say. We're very good at embodying other people's embodiments. It's a particular talent that human beings have, and we're so good at that that we imitate all sorts of things that aren't even human. And so then you view this expansive night sky, and a sense of awe fills you as you confront the infinite. It goes to something inside of you that can master the infinite. And that's a form of imitation, right? To look into the darkest place, the most wide expanse possible, and to have something inside you respond that's capable of dealing with that. That's that instinct to imitate. And that's calling the best out of you, and that's why you love doing that. And it isn't just that you love it, it's that you cannot live without it. You cannot live without it. And I know so many of you, atheist or otherwise, you can't live without music. You think, well, why can you not live without music? What is it calling to precisely? You know, that remarkable interplay of harmonious patterns, because that's what music is, and that's what the world is. It's not objects, it's the harmonious interplay of patterns, and music reflects that, and then you orient yourself in your embodied manner to those patterns and dance along with the world. And that revivifies you. And if you're particularly good at, well, maybe you'll also attract a mate. And you want a mate that doesn't attempt to dominate you sexually during the introductory dance, right? You want a mate who will play along with you and match your movements to theirs so that you can see that there's a harmonious interplay between the two of you as you meet in play, soul to soul, if you can manage it. And everyone knows that. And that capacity that's called out in the dance is the same capacity that's called out by the night sky. And it's the same thing that's represented in those Byzantine churches. You look deep enough into infinity and you find your destiny. And that destiny is everything you could be. And we all know that because, and this is what men and women search for in each other. You know, if you're rejected by a woman, well, why is she rejecting you? Well, maybe her judgment is off and that would be very, what would you say, convenient for you. But she's rejecting you because you are not all that you could be and maybe not even all that you need to be. And so that's a very painful rejection and it causes all sorts of tension between men and women. But, you know, women have a lot at stake in this game. And so they're looking for something, what, powerful, dominating, brutal, terrible? No. Something perhaps capable of that. But even more important, capable of mastering it, right? And capable of singing despite that. We all know that's true, and the shame that men feel when they're rejected by women is precisely the shame that they feel at knowing deep in their heart that they have not lived up to what they are capable of being. And that harsh judgment that women lay on men, which, by the way, is part of our sexual evolution, because we were shaped by sexual selection, which, by the way, is the operation of consciousness on the structures of matter at the most basic possible level. Well, it's a terrible rejection, but it's a salutary rejection. And that process of differentiated choice has shaped us into what we are. That action of consciousness, wanting the best from a potential partner and selecting at least in part on that basis. And men participate in that too, in the Meistersinger manner. You know, men aren't competing for dominance with each other constantly in a zero-sum game to achieve sexual dominance. There's an element of that, right? Because some things are a zero-sum game, but men are perfectly capable and more than willing, in fact, to aggregate themselves into skilled groups and to celebrate the elevation of the most skilled above all else. And so we see this cooperative venture between men and women over the longest run of possible time in producing some refinement of the human spirit in embodied form. And we want that from everyone. We require that from everyone. We're thrilled to the core of our soul when we encounter it in a conversation or in a course or in a work of art that calls to us in that manner. We need to know this increasingly. We need to know all this consciously. You know? We've acted it out. We've produced images to represent it. It tugs at our heartstrings. It manifests itself in our dreams and our works of art, our literary works. It's all lurking there in some sense. And it's not the satanic power of corrupt oppression, not fundamentally. That's a far weaker force than that which can overcome it. And everything around us would be nothing but hell if that's all there was. And everything around us is not only hell. And for fragile and broken creatures, ignorant to the core, we don't do too badly, and people are capable of a nobility, especially under the duress of suffering, that's virtually miraculous when you encounter it. And it's so heartening to see that, and you've seen it in the people that you love when they're going through terrible trials. You know, people become corrupt and embittered by their catastrophes, and it's no wonder. But certainly, in the main, that's not the fundamental human response. The fundamental human response is keep calm and carry on, you know. And good on you for that. So, well, to sum up, let's say, we solve the power of perception with the divine word. That's how it is. And what does that mean? Well, it means truth. Every word a prayer, right? Every word a groping to find a firm foundation to stand on while you make your way through life, that every time you hear a conversation of that sort, or hear yourself participating in that prayerful process, orienting yourself to this highest uniting good, and using that to govern your utterance, it's balm for the soul. Yeah, it's love that guides that, and love is the desire to work for the betterment of all things. And that's the proper orienting response, we could say. And it's truth nested inside of that. And that's how it is. And that's how it should be. And that's how it may forever be.